giving da'wah to other people. Unfortunately, most of us only think of one phase of da'wah. And that phase is the very final or the very last phase. For most of us, da'wah translates as public debates, as pamphlets and brochures, as going door to door, as engaging intellectually with the other and talking about our faith, proving to them the truth of our faith and that other understandings of God and of hereafter are not correct. And the fact of the matter is that this is but one aspect of da'wah. And it is also an aspect that most people are not qualified to get into. Most people are not Ahmadinats or Zakirites. And it is in fact dangerous for them to go to that level. The average Muslim cannot have a public debate with a pastor or a rabbi or something. That's going to be a disaster of the highest magnitude. And yet for most of us, our da'wah, when we think of that one face. And today, inshallah, in the 20 so minutes that I have, I want to explain and clarify to you that da'wah is in fact much more than just that. And in fact, most Muslims don't even need to get to that level. And they can be very effective da'is in other ways. If we look at the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there are so many principles of da'wah that we can derive. And today I will extract three of them that insha'Allah ta'ala are tangible for all of us sitting here. Regardless of how much knowledge we have in the Bible, of the Old Testament, of this, of that. And by the way, I have to point out here that subhanAllah, most of us were born in the era or raised in the era of Ahmadinat, right? Even myself, when I was like 12, 13 years old, the first videos that I ever saw was that of Ahmadinat. And Allah blessed me to meet him a few times as well in Jeddah and in Houston when he came. And definitely he had a profound impact on me. But many of us are still living in that era of the 80s. And we don't realize that the bulk of society around us doesn't care about these abstract Christian issues. They're not really even Christian by faith. They're humanist seculars, they're agnostic atheists. And we, most of us, not even qualified to begin talking to them about the existence of God, about how we explain the need of religion, about so on and so forth. So not only are most Muslims not even intellectually qualified, because the fact of the matter is this is a very unique specialization, but even when they start studying antiquated things, things that are no relevance of our times. The average American now is more agnostic than Christian. The types of issues he or she will raise have nothing to do with what, you know, Ahmadinejad used to talk about back in the 80s. So what then can we do to give da'wah at an individual level, at a basic level? Today, inshallah, I'll concentrate on three. Of course, these are not the only three, but time only permits me to mention three of them. The first of these three things, which is, I think, of utmost importance, of greatest importance, is the fact that people need to see the impact and reality of Islam on our personal lives. We all know that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was known as As-Sadiq and Al-Amin. But we don't really think about why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to do this. He was known as As-Sadiq and Al-Amin decades before he was known as Al-Rasul and Al-Nabi. He was known as As-Sadiq and Al-Amin decades before he was known as Al-Rasul and Al-Nabi. And for most of us, we want to jump to what he was doing as a Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meaning talk about the theology of Islam, without going through the necessary preconditions of having the people acknowledge you to be As-Sadiq and Al-Amin. You need to have a character, an akhlaq, a manner that is already established amongst the people. They need to see the reality of this faith in your actions before they hear it in your speech. And there are so many examples of this. I mean, the famous hadith of Tirmidhi of Abdullah ibn Salam, that when he came to the Prophet, when the Prophet came to in Medina, the hijrah took place, and Abdullah ibn Salam was a learned rabbi, he was the most learned rabbi of Medina. What did he say when he saw the face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? فَعَرَفْتُ أَنَّ وَجْهَهُ لَيْسَ بِوَجْهِ كَذَا. I could see that his face was not the face of a liar. Because you see, the reality is, iman has a spiritual impact on the soul and body. We can sense, I mean, I'm not trying to get mystical here, but it is true. We can sense a divine light. We can sense a spiritual presence in the company of those who are genuinely righteous. And because Abdullah ibn Salam himself was an alim and a scholar and a spiritual person, he could detect simply by looking at the face of the Prophet, being in the presence of the Prophet, this is not a man who tells a lie. I looked at his face and I could see his face was not the face of a liar. Now there's no doubt that we cannot reach that level of the Prophet. That's infinitely high. But we need to get on that footstep. We need to get on that path. That when somebody interacts with us, knows us, they know this is an honest person, a trustworthy person. And realize as well, to be called a Sadiq al-Amin means that our Prophet has established a track record without a single mistake. Amongst the poor, amongst the rich, amongst the elite, amongst the known, amongst the unknown, amongst men, amongst women, amongst the people of Makkah, amongst strangers. There was a consistency of his akhlaq. So much so, I mean, all of us speak the truth most of the time. Human beings, by their fitrah, they are truthful people. And lies are exceptions. But our Prophet ﷺ established the height of speaking the truth. The height of being honest. The height of being trustworthy. So much so that it became known to be his nature. And you know, recently I posted this on Facebook, around me, if you follow my Facebook. Recently, and literally was it last weekend? SubhanAllah, I've been traveling 7 weekends non-stop. I think it was last weekend that I was in London, England, and I met the oldest convert that I have ever met in my life. I posted this on my Facebook page. He is now 89 years old, he's gonna turn 90 this year. 90-year-old man. And he converted at the age of 83 or so. I mean, imagine, 83-year-old convert. And he's from they told me that he's from a very prestigious, you know, illustrious, noble family of England. That, you know, his ancestors were, you know, landowners and noblemen and whatnot. And he's from a very well-known family. And I asked him his story. You know, I had to yell at him very loudly because he had lost his hearing. I had to speak to him slowly. But his memory of old was very clear. They told me that he's losing memory of to what's happening today and yesterday. But he remembers what happened 50 years ago, 7 years ago. So I asked him, what was your conversion story? Why did you convert at the age of 83? I've never met a convert at the age of 83. So listen to his story, and this shows you the reality of having a Sadiq al-Amin's characteristics. He told me that after World War II, he was told to go fight in World War II, he refused. Excuse me. And he said, he doesn't want to go kill anybody. I don't want to kill anybody, no human being, I'm not going to kill him. So he refused to go to World War II, he turned that offer down, even though it was a very prestigious offer. They were going to take him to the academy that is the most prestigious academy in England, to the Royal Sandhurst Academy. Maybe some of you have heard of it. If you graduate from Sandhurst, you will go very far in the British aristocracy. And he got into that, but the condition was you have to go fight for 2 years and then come. He goes, no, I'm not going to go fight. So he turned that offer down. After World War II, as a young man, 22, 23 years old, we're talking about 1945. He gets a job offer to go and work in a tea factory in Indonesia. So he goes for a tea factory and he becomes the plantation manager, managing the teas, you know, making sure the harvest is and whatnot. And he told me that was the first time I heard of Islam. Never heard of Islam until that time. And the first time I met Muslims. So he told me, my interaction with those Muslims continued to be with me until I came back, and for the next 60 years, I kept on thinking about my interactions with those Muslims. And I bought the Quran, and I used to always listen to Islamic lectures online or whatever. Until one day I'm walking in Hyde Park and there was a da'wah table over there, and I went up to them and I told them I want to convert to Islam. 83 years old. The da'wah was not given to him at the da'wah table. The da'wah table was the final catalyst. That's the end result. He didn't need to be given da'wah. He in fact knew the Quran had read it many times. So I asked him, what was it about the Muslims of Indonesia that caused you to think about them for 60 years? 60 years! He's never met a Muslim in England. Because of his aristocratic background, because of his circle of friends, he's never met a Muslim. So what is it about these laborers, these peasants, that is having you to have such an impact? Instantaneously, he told me, their manners. Their manners impacted me so much. I wanted to know what their faith was. And then he also said, and their salah, that they would go into the river and do wudu in front of him and then pray. And it really made him feel good to look at them pray. But before he mentioned prayer, wallahi, I swear by Allah, before he mentioned even salah, he said, their manners, that it impacted me so much. Now wallahi, this like really it shook me to the core. These Indonesian workers never even spoke to him about da'wah, tawheed, akhirah, risalah, you know, the Bible says this and this, and nothing. But their da'wah was more powerful than any pamphlet they could have shoved into his face. Think about that. Their da'wah was more effective than anything they could have said. And that is the type of da'wah that we need to bring back. The most important da'wah you can give to your colleagues, to your co-workers, to your friends, to your neighbors, has nothing to do with publications and pamphlets, with literature, with videos, with links. No! The most important da'wah is who you are in front of them. Your mannerisms, your akhlaq. Your perfection of إِنَّمَا بُعِثُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. I have only been sent to perfect all good manners. 3 weeks ago, I was in Singapore and Malaysia. I did a trip of both of these countries. I've been to Malaysia before. Singapore was the first time I had been to. And once again, I'm asking them, what is it that has caused Malaysia to become a Muslim majority country, one of the largest Muslim countries in the world? Malaysia and then Indonesia is of course the largest country in the world, despite the fact that not a single army has ever invaded. No Muslim naval force has gone to that region. No Muslim Khalifa has sent, you know, professional da'i, nothing. And yet the entire islands have converted. Earlier in the year I was in Maldives as well. 100% Muslim islands. And never, never has any ruler come and invaded. The whole islands, and there are thousands of islands in Maldives, are all Muslim. What is the story of these people? And they say all the same things. The Muslim traders that came in the 1100s, 1200s, 1300s, the Muslim traders that came, their honesty, their akhlaq, their dealings with the people, continued to impress more and more and more people until finally, pretty much the majority of the Malay population embraced Islam. Pretty much, I mean it's not 100%, but the ethnic Malays, because in Malaysia there are multiple ethnicities, you have the Chinese that have also come, you have the Indians that have also come in the last 100 years, but the ethnic people of the land, they're called the Malay, the ethnic people of the land, the vast majority of them, I don't know the statistic, but 90-something%, are Muslim. Despite the fact that they've never had a Muslim army come to them, or a Muslim professional da'i sent to them. What was the cause? The akhlaq of the Muslim traders. They could see in them iman and taqwa. And the Malay people, mashallah, they're so nice people, you all know this. They're such humble people, they're such good people. When they saw the goodness of these traders, over the span of 300-400 years, conversions continued to take place. Now, no doubt there are certain catalysts as well. I'm not being naive here that it was Indo. No, the catalysts were what, by the way? The rulers converting. When the rulers converted, there were many kingdoms there. When the rulers began to convert, then the entire populations followed. But why did the rulers convert? For the same reason. The honesty, the akhlaq of the Muslim traders. So we see this in our own history, in our own global impact, that what has reached these vast majority Muslim lands, the largest Muslim country in the world is Indonesia, over 200 million Muslims, and not a single army ever went there. So the largest principalities of Islam were converted, and this is historical fact, not by the power of astaghfirullah, the sword, not even by the power of pamphlets and literature or academic da'wah. debates, bashing other people with no. They were simply converted by what? Good manners. So, number one point. You want to give da'wah to others? Make sure you embody the reality of Islam. Cheerful attitude, optimism, good akhlaq, honesty, good work. All of these are characteristics of Islam. And if you are known in your business, in your principality, in your locality, in your amongst your colleagues, as being the best person in terms of your human characteristics, then automatically your religious characteristics will be appreciated by them. The second mechanism of da'wah, the second reality of da'wah at a societal level, so the first as an individual, the second as a societal level, is to give back to your community and to take care of the needs of the entire community. The problems of the community. What are the problems of the community? Not the religious problems, because most people don't think of religion immediately. But everybody can see the social problems around us. And if you look at the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, once again, we notice that before he was a Rasul, before he was a Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what was he doing for 40 years? We have in the story of Khadija radiallahu anha, what she said to the Prophet ﷺ when he came back from Ghar al-Kiram. She summarized the life of the Prophet ﷺ. She said to him, لا والله لا يخزيك الله أبدا. No, by Allah, Allah will never cause you to go mad. Meaning, you are not seeing delusions, you're seeing something real. Why? She gave a beautiful paragraph. إِنَّكَ لَتَصِلُ الرَّحِيمِ. You are good to your family. And you feed the poor. And you take care of the orphan. And you help the needy. And you do everything that requires some good to be done. You're the one at the forefront. Now, again, many of us, we gloss over this, we jump over this, and we get to the point of, oh, da'wah is what pamphlet am I going to get? What am I going to say? What am I going to debate? But before our process to open his mouth to preach La ilaha illallah, he had established credibility amongst the people. He had what we call social credibility. And that social credibility was, this is a man who loves us, he cares about us, he has taken care of our needy, he has fed the poor, he is a person who takes care of the orphans. Nobody could doubt his sincerity. He was a visible presence. And I have spoken in a lot of detail about this in a number of lectures I've given, especially the lecture that deals with Hilf al-Fudul. That our Prophet ﷺ, being the youngest member, he took care of a social problem of injustice. Hilf al-Fudul is all about social injustice, where the rich take advantage of the poor, where the elite get away with trampling on the rights of those who are not elite. And our Prophet ﷺ was at the forefront of challenging that. You have no right to steal the money of a person just because he's not a Qurashi. And he was the one, at the youngest person in the whole gathering, who signed his name. And he was proud of that. And he said, even 60 years later, at the age of 60, excuse me, he said that I was there in the house of Ibn Jud'an when they signed the Hilf al-Fudul. And I would not give up my place in that room for a herd full of camels, meaning for $1 million. I wouldn't substitute my place for $1 million. I'm so proud to have been there. And even if now they call me to uphold Hilf al-Fudul, I will be the first one to respond to that call. Now, why don't we think about the reality of Hilf al-Fudul and what does it signify? It signifies that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is at the forefront of social change, of equality, of justice. And that means we in our society need to take on the social ills of our times. Poverty, injustice, racism. Look at America of 2015. Look at the problems of police brutality, of racism, still to this day. Muslims need to be at the forefront of these issues. Not because we want the PR, not because we want the Kodak moment, not because we want to give da'wah based upon that. No! Being at the forefront of social issues is da'wah. It's not a precursor to da'wah. It's not a, no, that in and of itself is what Allah wants us to do. Look at some of the earliest commandments in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا. of the earliest verses, perhaps within the first 10 revelations, very early on, before there's an Islamic state, before there are mass converts, before there's hundreds of Muslims, when there's barely a dozen or two dozen Muslims, Allah says of the characteristics of the believers is what? They feed those who have no food, even though they love this food themselves. وَيُطْعِمُوا الطَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ And they give it to the miskeen, they give it to the yateen, they give it to the prisoner of war. Now pause here. When this verse comes down, there are no Muslim yateen, Muslim faqir, Muslim prisoner of war. This is Mecca. This is pagan Mecca. These are idol worshippers. Idol worshippers. Yet Allah says, the Muslim is the one who wants to give his own food to the idol worshipping yateen, to the idol worshipping prisoner of war, to the idol worshipping faqir. When it comes to racism, when it comes to hunger, it doesn't matter what your religion is. We are commanded to help you when you're hungry. Not because we want to give da'wah based upon that, but because that is what our religion is. وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ We are feeding you for the sake of Allah. لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا We don't want your thanks. We don't want the Kodak moment. We don't want the news media to come and say just because of this is our religion. So our niyya is not the Kodak moment. Now if they come and take a picture and publish it, that's their business. But that's not our niyya. Our niyya is إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ And unfortunately, again, most of us, we completely jump over this important mechanism of being a Muslim and a precursor to actually opening our mouths. Wallahi, my dear brothers and sisters, one of our biggest mistakes, and I speak as somebody who's a part of you and a part of us, is our mistake. I'm not criticizing anyone, all of us here, is that we neglected the problems of this land. And we concentrate on the problems of lands that we consider lands back home. And all you need to do is to see how much money can be raised for foreign causes versus how much money can be raised for local causes. And this is not to deny that foreign causes have need. Wallahi, we need to give to Palestine, we need to give to Syria, we need to give to Kashmir, we need to give to every flood that happened in Pakistan, every zelzala that takes place, everything we need to give to. But we also need to give to our local homeless shelter here. We need to give to the local soup kitchen. How much do we raise for the local soup kitchens? How much do we raise for the family shelters? Barely 20,000, 30,000 with great difficulty. Yet when we have a fundraiser for Kashmir, for Pakistan, for India, for Timbuktu, mashallah, 100,000, 200,000, 300,000. I have raised myself, alhamdulillah, more than $1 million on one night for the Palestinian crisis. And wallahi, they deserve it. Wallahi, they deserve it. But I'm not saying we don't give to them. But I'm saying, why is it so easy to give $1 million to some project overseas and we can barely raise $10,000 for the local people over here that are hungry? So when we don't invest in our own societies, don't be surprised when we go knocking on doors and shoving pamphlets down people's face. They're like, who are you guys? We've never seen you before. You have no relationship with our society. Because we have not invested, for most of us, and this is primarily an immigrant problem, and I'm the children of immigrants, so again, I'm criticizing myself here. For most of us, we still have not come to terms with the fact that this is our land. We're still thinking of things back home. Psychologically, subconsciously, we're thinking back home. And we're not thinking this land is our land, and we need to invest in this land in order for us to be known to the people. It is high time we understood that as a part of our religion, we need to tackle the social challenges of our society. Just like early Islam talked about female infanticide. Early Islam talked about the fact that you treat orphans nicely. Early Islam talked about feeding the hungry. So what were the problems in our times? Racism, brutality issues, this and that, drugs, whatever are the issues. We need to be at the forefront. And simply when the people see us doing that, automatically they will come to us. And they will say, what is it that's causing you to do this? Then you can open your mouth and say, oh, this is what Allah has told me to feed you. That's it. That is your da'wah. You don't even need to hand a pamphlet to him. Allah has told me, I mean, this is my religion. I am required to be good, charitable, humane, etc., etc. And again, most of us completely jump over this, and for us, da'wah becomes studying Christianity classes, studying what the Old Testament says. Ya akhi, this da'wah is for the 1%. I'm not making fun of it, but 1% of the ummah should go advanced studies of Christianity, Judaism, Buddhism, Agnosticism. But 100% of the ummah should be good Muslims. Correct? 100% of the ummah should be practicing that type of da'wah, which is being good to their neighbors, feeding the hungry. And we want to jump over that, and da'wah just becomes for us these intellectual debates and bashing other religions and, you know, verse this and chapter that. This is for the elite, for the very few. And the final point, my time is up, the final point of da'wah is consistency and being proactive in any circumstance and situation you find yourself in. Always bringing khair and good to whatever circumstance, whatever place you're in. What good impact can you do to the people? It doesn't matter where you are, what gathering you're in, how small, how big. You need to cause a positive impact. Even if it's just a positive word, a smile, whatever it is. Because you do not know where the seed that you plant will actually sprout. You do not know which seed, which smile, which handshake, which good manners will cause an impact that will bring about an entire revolution. Simple example is that of the Prophet ﷺ wanting to find another tribe other than the Quraysh to sponsor him. When the Quraysh cut him off, when Abu Talib died, as you know the story, Abu Talib died, Abu Lahab took over, his other uncle, and Abu Lahab said, "You have no place in Mecca, get out of here." So the Prophet had to go find another tribe. And he's looking at the big tribes, the fancy tribes, because that's human nature. Nothing wrong with that. You want the powerful tribes to protect you. He goes to Kindah, he goes to Hawazin, he goes to the Bani Tamim, he goes to the big tribes. And he says, "Will you adopt me?" Meaning, will you give me the visa to go to your land? Because my people have cut me off. And he emphasized those big tribes, but he never neglected the no-name tribes. And the story is well known, that between two of these famous tribes, he's walking and he sees six people sitting there in Hajj, in Mina. And he says, "Who are you?" So they said, "We are the Khazraj." "Khazraj? Who's the Khazraj? You're not the big name." So he had to ask, "Which Khazraj?" Then something goes on, "Oh, the Khazraj of the Yahud of Yathrib." The Khazraj are not even like the Khazraj of the Yahud. The Yahud are more famous than you guys. "Which Khazraj?" "Oh, the Khazraj of the Yahud of Yathrib." They said, "Yes, that Khazraj." So he said, "Can I speak with you?" They said, "Yes." So he sat down and he gave them the same passion, the same ikhlas, the same message, the same quality time that he reserved for the big and fancy tribes. And then he went on thinking nothing of it. Didn't even think, move on. Because what's the Khazraj going to do? What are they going to help me out with? They're nobodies. They're the poor tribe. Khazraj were the poor tribe of Medina, of Yathrib at the time. Yet, Allah Azza wa Jalla knows where the seed is going to sprout. And what happened? The Khazraj went back and they kept on talking about it for an entire year. The next year, they said, "You know what? We agree. We have to embrace this faith." They bring 12 people. And the first Treaty of Aqaba takes place. Even then, the Prophet was not thinking that this group is going to actually sponsor me, because who are the Khazraj still to give me protection from the rest of the tribes? But those 12 people give da'wah to another 200. And from that 200, 72 come, including women. And they say, "Ya Rasulullah, we now have hundreds of Muslims in Medina, in Yathrib. You come and we shall protect you." They make the offer to the Prophet ﷺ. "You come and we shall protect you. And we promise we're going to fight with our wives, with our children, with our families. We're going to fight for your right to practice Islam." And lo and behold, that small conversation that was given to an unknown tribe, it literally changed the course of history. So my dear brothers and sisters, you do not know the people you're talking to, what will happen to them 10, 20, 30 years down the line. You do not know what conversation, what positive impact, wherever you are, whenever you find yourself in any type of situation or gathering, ask yourself, what can I do to bring about something good in this gathering? What can I do to leave a positive impact, even if it's just a positive word? And I conclude the famous hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that if one of you has a sapling, a small tree, and you hear the trumpet of the Day of Judgment, and you are able to plant that tree before you die, then go ahead and plant it.
And the hadith is Muslim Imam Ahmad. And this is an amazing hadith. Amazing hadith. Why is it amazing? And this is my final point, I know my time is up. Why is it amazing? Because there will be no Muslims alive when the trumpet is blown. Before the trumpet, the Muslims will be taken away. So the hadith is not actually meant to be followed literally. But the point is to give you the ultimate role model of being a Muslim. The day of judgment, there is no life after it. Who's going to benefit from any tree that you plant? There will be no life. But our Prophet is saying, you don't know the future. Wherever you go, cause some khair, cause some good. If you can just do it before you die, do something good. Because at the end of the day, every tree that we eat from, somebody before us was thinking 50 years ahead, 100 years ahead for us to eat from that tree. Every project that we're benefiting from, there were people before us that laid the foundations for that project. So thinking long term, seeing what good you can do. This hadith teaches us that the good Muslim is a proactive Muslim, is a Muslim who thinks 10 steps ahead, is a Muslim who brings about any good, even if he or she does not immediately see the benefits of that good. The bottom line, dear brothers and sisters, should every Muslim give da'wah? Ay wallahi, every Muslim must give da'wah. But what does that mean? Remember these three points. Da'wah is not just about talk and pamphlets and literature. That's for the small percentage. Da'wah that is fard ayn, that is wajib on every Muslim, these are three examples of it. Number one, what is number one? Your personal akhlaq. Number two, khair in the community. Doing something beneficial for the community. And number three, being persistent and consistent in both of those two things. And wherever you are, whenever you are, do whatever good you can. That is the ultimate da'wah that every single Muslim is required to do. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all ikhlas. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all to follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah azza wa jal grant us all iman in this world and in the akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cause us to live as Muslims, to die as mu'mins, and to be resurrected with the prophets and the martyrs and the siddiqeen and shuhada and salihin. Wa hasuna ulaika rafiqa. Wa jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.